Happy Monday again, everybody. I am so excited to be here, especially with Nneka, who is going to be joining us shortly to talk about her work and all the amazing things that she's doing. If you haven't already checked out her work, you're gonna want to because it is beautiful and powerful and starts conversations. It is awesome. So I see Anika's already in here, so she will be joining us here shortly. As always, if y'all have any questions along the way and you are wanting to know, maybe what, if you have some questions for her, you are welcome to type that into the chat and then I will keep an eye on those as well to make sure that we can answer all those questions. So for those of you that don't know, I'm Sarah Krajewski, elementary art teacher and run your weekly Instagram live chats through the Art of Ed. And we are psyched to chat today. So I am gonna get Nneka going here. Here we go. Get her going. She's gonna join here in just a second. So be ready to welcome her with some emojis, some hearts. Super psyched to chat with her. Again, if y'all have, hi, Nneka.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm great, how are you?
Good, good. We're so excited that you're joining us today.
I'm excited to be here.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you. We have a good group of people here ready to chat with us and a few friends that are interested in adding questions along the way. Y'all go ahead and type those into the chat as we discuss. So we are just going to jump right into it. So Nneka, can you just tell us a little bit about who you are as an artist for people that may or may not have already checked out your work?
Of course. So I'm originally from Trinidad and Tobago. I actually am currently in Tampa, Florida, but I came to Tampa in 2016. So I was originally an art student at the University of Tampa and graduated last year in May.
Congrats.
And since then, thank you. A crazy thing to graduate.
Yes,
but
yes.
I was able to get through everything safely. But yeah, since graduating, I've just been practicing as an activist artist because I feel like throughout my time at the University of Tampa, my work kind of evolved from just focusing on my developing my technical skills to more focusing on the meaning behind my work and how I could use portraiture and the use of faces and the use of emotions to bring that out and bring that narrative out, specifically with raising awareness about different issues in society.
Yeah, absolutely. I think your images are so powerful. It is obvious that you kind of get drawn into them and you want to hear that story. You want to figure out sort of what story you're trying to tell. So I'm going to say a quote that is on your website, but also is just one that I think is really interesting to talk about. It says, there's the artwork, the story behind the artwork, and the story that the artwork tells, right? So can you just tell us a little bit, some of the stories you've been investigating and been trying to share with people through your work?
So my work is very experimental, and I work in mixed media. And that actually was not intentional at the start. I just wanted to be a painter, and I was into drawing. And then when I was at the University of Tampa, I took an experimental painting class that kind of pushed me beyond my boundaries that I had set for myself. And it allowed me to kind of think of non-traditional materials that I would be able to incorporate in my work that makes the work non-conventional and also allows you to look deeper than just the portrait, look into the texture of the materials and what that could kind of convey with the symbolism.
Yeah.
So we started my first ever series, which I think dealt with a lot of activism, using the artwork to bring awareness to social issues, was my Sex Target series, where I used condoms on canvas, actual condoms, and sticking hundreds of them onto the canvas, which was really weird for me at first. extremely weird, but it wasn't my choice. My professor kind of pushed me in giving me the actual material, but I had to find some way to kind of combine that material with what was happening currently. And of course, sex trafficking, human trafficking, all of that was on the rise at the time. And I thought it was the perfect way to kind of marry that material and content.
Yeah.
So that was my first series where I started diving into doing more research into sex trafficking and human trafficking and realizing that the statistics were leading to leaning on the side more so of people of color being of the highest statistic or the highest percentage that were being affected by this. So my series kind of at that stage was kind of highlighting and reflecting that using symbolism and portraiture, but really focusing on people of color, young girls of color at the time.
Yeah, and I think, you know, there's many different materials that you've experimented with along the way, and we've shared many of those images, and you can see them in your work as well. And I think part of what's so interesting about the way that you draw people in is that your work is so detailed that you can't help but get close to it, right? So you have to see it close. From afar, it looks totally different than it does when you're right up close to it. So you're, the way you work intentionally makes someone want to come close and really investigate what you're using and what you're doing. So I think that's a really interesting choice too. And that's clear in your work too. So that is a great jumping off point as well. So let's just chat a little bit about your process, right? Because we've seen a couple other art teachers and creatives and people commenting in here saying that they love using your work as an example of activist artists or people that can use art as advocacy. So how do you actually sort of decide your subject, decide what you're going to tackle, and what does your process look like to as you start working on new pieces?
So for me, choosing the topic, because I work basically in bodies of work, I don't just create one piece that represents that specific topic. I like using different perspectives and kind of using the canvas or whatever material that I'm using as that perspective. So once I develop that concept for the series, I kind of start visualizing images, and those images would come from things that I've either seen in everyday life or people that I've seen in everyday life, and I kind of collage that. And of course, that's influenced by things that are happening in everyday life, which would be connected to the social issues, political issues, environmental issues, etc. And so the process really begins in my head and me visualizing it and kind of brainstorming how that concept would translate into the canvas and translate to into a composition and into materials. And once I'm able to have that concept, I kind of start doing more research on different images. Sometimes I would actually take my own photos, or use actual photos that I've seen before and kind of collage that on Photoshop to create this specific image or this specific person that represents basically that body, that person that's highlighting this issue. And from then is when I could actually start either embroidering on canvas or painting or sculpting or doing the mixed media work. Because I think if I would flip to where I actually just started on the canvas immediately without the idea, my brain is kind of like, it's too abstract for me.
Yes.
It's a very structured process.
Yeah.
So it's very thought out in terms of it being in my head first, then research, then actually getting physical and getting on canvas.
Yeah, absolutely. Something that's so precise as embroidery and your super photorealistic painting, all of that definitely needs more planning than just going for it. At least it appears that way. I love artwork where you kind of like have to come in closer and decide, how did they do this? How did it work? How can you like pull those layers off just a little bit and see it for the steps that it took to get there? So as powerful as your imagery is, I think it also speaks to the way you do the process of creating it also pulls people in, right? The imagery itself, but also the way it's created is really beautiful as well. Okay, so I know you're constantly advocating and constantly sharing resources and creating new work. We've also spoken and done many speaking events, specifically with Adobe Max. Can you tell us just a little bit about what you've spoken about there and some other speaker events that you've done?
That was actually, it's so surreal that I was able to actually speak as a keynote speaker at Adobe Max. I've heard so many good reviews about it and it being one of the biggest conferences for the top creatives in the industry. So for me to be invited just after about 4 months after graduating was just crazy for me. But I was glad that I was able to be selected, because I think the selection process, the judges that actually told me about the process were like, we selected you because of the type of the artwork that you do and the story that came with your artwork, meaning the story behind you and your work. And me being from Trinidad and kind of translating and changing my background and my location and being in a different environment, but having that same, those same issues that I've experienced in Trinidad and seeing that hair and noticing that it's a global issue, a global issue that happened, I think was very inspiring to them. And they thought, of course, this would be something that a lot of other creatives would like to share or would like to hear about and be able to share and pass on to others.
Right.
So my speech for Adobe really focused on how I kind of transitioned from being in Trinidad and noticing these different things and experiencing the Trinidadian culture and growing up there, but also coming over here and coming into my new skin as an artist, but also experiencing the not so good side of things as well.
Right. So sort of balancing as an artist, but also as a human, how those sort of came together for you, right? And what that looks like. I know we'll link to at least a portion of your chat, if not the whole thing, after this in the story. So you'll want to check that out, because you not only do you get to see inside your studio and see the process of you working, but it's really nice to see an artist speak about their work with visuals as well too, because we could see your beautiful portrait behind you, but it's so you know, dramatic to be able to see those details up close. So I will be sure to link that as well, so people can check out that that speech for you, or kind of that speaker event. Now there's so many things that you've had going on. You are constantly creating. You're featured in many, many articles, many resources that we can share with our students as art educators, but also just people who love to learn about you as an artist. So can you tell us about one of your more recent accomplishments, which was being featured on the cover of Time magazine? That is an incredible accomplishment, so congratulations. And go ahead and tell us a little bit about what that was like.
That was also surreal.
Yes.
That happened a couple of months after graduating as well. So after I had lost my graduation during the pandemic, I actually decided that I was just going to start posting a lot more on Instagram and on Facebook, etc., kind of getting my artwork out there in other forms, just because everyone was at home, we lost art festivals, exhibitions, etc. And I needed to still put my artwork out there and get a lot of people to see it. And so within a month of doing that, one of the art directors from Time magazine actually noticed my work. And just like you said, at first he stopped and he realized there was something deeper, and it wasn't just a painting, it was actually hand embroidered.
Right.
He immediately emailed me and was like, we need to work together. I think your work would actually pair well with a project that we're working on with Pharrell Williams. It's curated by Pharrell Williams. And we think that this would be a good project just for the cover of Time magazine, not just something that's featured inside of the magazine.
That's awesome.
So
you're okay.
Again, I thought I was dreaming all of this. Like, I still can't believe it. But yeah, so I basically had about 3 days of going back and forth with him, and we actually came down to about a day before the project was due, and it was a hand-embroidered project, and I had never done a hand-embroidered work in less than 24 hours, and I had never done one in less than probably a week or so. So I actually had less than 24 hours to complete the hand-embroidered flat, and somehow I pulled it off, and within the next day, I was able to see it published on Time's Instagram and have them send a couple of magazines to me, etc. So it was all surreal, but it was, of course, worth it just because of the message behind the piece and it being related to optimism. And it was that, in that chaotic time, I think that kind of piece was necessary, especially on a cover of such a big publication.
I agree completely. So if those of you that aren't familiar with the image, can you just tell us what you embroidered for the cover, and what the story was behind the choices that you made for that image?
Of course. So the piece is actually hanging right behind me. So it's the American flag, but I tilted it so that it's hanging vertically. And so it's actually incomplete with the needle left in the canvas. And what we really wanted to communicate was changing the narrative and allowing Black creative, Black entrepreneurs, and everyone to have an equal space within America, and kind of redefining and remolding how the structure of things are, and making sure that we have a future that's optimistic. But it's noticing that we're going to have to be a community, and it's going to be a work in progress, and it's not something that's going to happen overnight, which is why the needle is left in there, so that one, you can notice that it's not a painting of just a flag and it's on the cover of Time magazine, but it's something that's actually stitched. It's intentional, and that needle is there to say that it's incomplete, because we all need to do our part to make sure that it comes together and it's unified in the future.
That is a beautiful way to describe it too. And I think that the conversation around that is obviously so important. And as an art educator, I could see students being able to get that, even young students, seeing that it's sort of incomplete, but it's transitioning, that black becomes red slowly, and there's a story being told, but you're also giving a nod to how it was created, like you were saying, with the needle in there, is really an interesting conversation starter. So I could see just showing that image with nothing else to students and seeing what conversation comes from that can be, as said by many other people in the chat here, so powerful, right? It just opens your brain up to having those conversations and using that art to start those big conversations. So thank you for having the artistic mindset to be able to make those images for us to start those conversations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. That is a great accomplishment and a beautiful cover. Okay, so speaking to art education just a little bit, like I said, since we're chatting through the Art of Ed, a resource for art educators, what was your experience like as a younger student? What did you have any art educators that really helped you along the way, or something that you wish they would have done? What was that like coming up as a flourishing artist?
Most definitely. I think throughout each stage of my career as an artist, or my journey as an artist, for a better word, I think each stage I've had a professor or a teacher or someone kind of guiding me.
Good.
And pushing me to go beyond my boundaries. And without having those professors and those teachers, I can confidently say I would not be where I am today. And I think it was really at the University of Tampa where I realized that my professors weren't just professors to me. Mm. They actually made sure that they were connecting with me on a personal level, and not just me, other students in the class. They made sure that there was that one-on-one where they were able to be personal with the students and understand what type of work they wanted to create, not just giving us assignments and having us completing it and giving us a grade.
Right.
Making sure that, you know, we knew what we wanted to create and we had some kind of connection towards it. Because I think once you have passion behind something and you have your personal self invested in that, it kind of brings up the standard of the work a little bit more. So it's more than just a grade, getting an A grade on the assignment. And to me, my assignments in school were more than just assignments. They've always been more than just assignments to me. And so I think my professors and my teachers at each stage kind of helped me step outside of my comfort zone, developing my technical skills, but also developing the way that I speak about my work, having critiques, showing my work to other people outside of the classroom setting, just to make sure that I got that confidence and I took those risks to make sure that I am where I am today.
That's a beautiful way to describe it. And I think that's the goal of hopefully most art educators, is to be there to provide that safe space for students, for no matter the age, knowing that it's about being able to talk about your art, but also just kind of pushing a little further to say, is there more? Is there something else that we need to add to really start that conversation? And what I'm hearing you say, Nneka, is that you having part of yourself be your art creations is what makes it so powerful, right? You're putting yourself into your work in some way, clearly, because of the way that you create. So I think that is something that we can tell our students too, is that what you put into your work, and if it's something that you love, it's going to be even more powerful along the way. That is clear. Now I have to ask, because there's so many beautiful images that you have, both your embroidered ones and your painted ones that are so, so photorealistic. You've done Kamala Harris photograph, that, or a painting, sorry, that was in the Washington Post, right? And all of those images are so, so beautiful and realistic. I'm so impressed. But can you tell us where do you get the photos from? Are they sometimes people that you know, like the young girls, or where do you get the imagery for the individuals?
So it's a combination of basically everything. Sometimes sure. I take the photos myself.
Mm-hmm.
I've asked my friends to just pose as models for me. Or sometimes I would get images from online and kind of collage those images in Photoshop so that I'm creating this person.
Sure.
And making my own artistic, again, putting myself into the artwork and making my own artistic identity, creating that identity out of collages of different people.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, for the larger publications, I would receive actual images and be asked to create a commission based on those images. So I'm not necessarily copying that image,
sure.
but I'm kind of creating my own identity of that person
right.
in a different way.
Yeah, especially when you're changing the materials, it naturally is going to look different because you're pulling from that original image. Okay, that's useful because sometimes it's nice to know if there's a story or a connection to a specific individual or if it's collected in a different way. So thank you for sharing that. Okay, so let's just chat a little bit about specifically all of these powerful social issues that you've been chatting about and trying to bring attention to. We know it's important, but can you just give us a little bit of your own words as to why it's important to bring awareness to those social issues for you specifically, but why is it important to talk about these things?
I think because it's uncomfortable speaking about it, that people don't actually speak about it at all, or it's kind of swept under the rug and people kind of breeze over it. Whereas with artwork, you feel more comfortable in allowing yourself to be submersed in the piece visually and connect emotionally. And then I think that brings you to another level where you're able to actually open up and speak about the work. Whether it's you're like exactly standing in front of the piece and talking to the actual work, or you're speaking to someone else who's looking at the piece. I've experienced it myself where I've been at art festivals or art exhibitions and people come up to the work and they're actually looking at it by themselves, but someone else will come and stand next to them and they'll start having a conversation about the work. So I think it's important in using art as that vehicle for starting conversations, just because these conversations are so uncomfortable for people to speak about, because that's just human nature and it's how it has been throughout history. It's tough because it's emotional and it's painful, but that doesn't mean that it's not supposed to be spoken about. It has to be just bringing a different perspective and using art to kind of push you beyond that boundary of your comfort zone of, it's okay not to speak about it, or we can speak about it, but let's cover it up with certain words. It's kind of bringing it raw and real and creating that narrative so that you're able to continue talking about it and passing that information on.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen many, many comments in here too, just how beautifully articulated that was to invite you into that discomfort. Because let's say, for example, you and I were going to start talking about race or sex trafficking or something. It can be hard to start that conversation. But when we have a visual component to say, oh, what do you notice about this? And how does that relate to what our students see or what we see or how we envision something? Then all of a sudden that conversation becomes a little bit easier to have, because it's like we're using that art as that scapegoat or that path or that door to open the conversation, right? So you're almost creating like tools and resources for conversations, right? It's artwork too, but you're making resources for us, and that's beautiful and so necessary.
And I think it's also even a resource for the artist as well, because like I said, when I first started with the condoms, I was still uncomfortable. The conversation, nobody was speaking to me while I was sticking the condoms on the camera.
Right.
Uncomfortable. but I think just using those layers of paint and layers of gesso and kind of collaging that into an image where I was comfortable speaking about it was what really made it worthwhile in the end.
Yeah. I think you're right. It's sort of pushing you outside your comfort zone, but making you think a little bit even deeper about what you want your artwork to say, right? And what you want that conversation to be a little bit. So where do you see yourself going in the future as far as like what kinds of pieces you're going to work on next, or what do you have in progress that you are excited to share? Can you give us a little sneak peek into where you see yourself going?
So this, with the portrait, the self-portrait that I have in the back, I think that's the direction that my work is kind of heading into with identity, not necessarily focusing on me as the subject, but just kind of using identity and silhouettes and playing with how I can use negative space and positive space and still capturing that detail and having that detail in my work. But what does the negative part of the canvas, or where there's nothing, what does that translate to? So right now I think my work is one, dealing with a different color palette, because my earlier works were reds and greens and very bold colors. But I think now I'm working with like pastels and lighter colors, and kind of using facial expressions that are bold or strong to kind of contrast that. So right now it's just the topic of identity. I'm still going to be using my work for activism, just because I think it's rooted in me to the point where I have to create work. Like, that's, I feel like that's my purpose, at least for right now or for a couple of years, but just in a different way.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, not to diminish the fact that speaking about identity is also a social issue, right? Is the fact that some people have their identity inhibited or cut because they can't be who they want to be. So you are still activating or being an activist by talking about those issues too, about being who you are and encouraging others to be able to do that as well. So I think I'm really excited to see where your artwork goes in the future as well. So unless we have any other questions in the chat here, I've got two more things for us, Nneka, and then we're going to cruise out of here. So the first one that I have was, I know there's so many articles that are amazing pieces for art educators to show their students that they want to share your work or share your story. But what kind of advice can you just give teachers or students or anybody that's watching moving forward about just encouraging ourselves to be great artists or educators or creatives? What advice do you have for us?
I would think that you should allow these students, one, to have that artistic freedom. I mean, being a teacher, yes, you still have those guidelines and stuff that you would want the student to follow and have that structure. But again, I think when I was at the University of Tampa, I had those guidelines and I had that structure, but I also still had the artistic freedom to just create work that really spoke to me, mm-hmm. and that kind of followed through with how my work developed. And if you hone in on a student too much, or you give them too much of a structure or too much of a limitation, I don't think it has that space of growth for them to grow as an artist and as an individual.
Right.
So just giving them that artistic freedom to kind of have both, the best of both worlds, having that structure, but also finding their artistic unique style of creating.
Yeah.
And then advice for an artist, I would say, is be bold and take risks. Because for me, I was just very uncomfortable at the start with doing anything other than painting.
Yeah.
Because that's what I've done all my life up until I had been at the university and taken the experimental painting class. But right now, I do paintings, but it's more so in the background. Right now, all of my work is mixed media. So
yeah.
Take risk and experiment and just have fun, be loose with it. And if it's up to you, if you want to be more intentional with your work, you can do that as well. But just take risks and enjoy that journey of transitioning throughout your artistic career.
I love that too. Giving yourself permission to try something that makes you uncomfortable, because as you know, sometimes those things really blossom into something beautiful and can really help you find your artistic voice. That is excellent advice. And I know a lot of people that are watching hopefully will be encouraged to try something that might be outside their comfort zone, and know that that is obviously okay. Thank you for your encouragement. I am really excited to share that with my students too. I teach elementary right now, and sometimes elementary we focus a lot on the process of how we use the materials, which makes sense, but really giving our students the opportunity to talk about themselves and to truly connect with what they're creating makes the pieces just come to life. So you're reminding me to do that as much as possible with our student work. So thank you for the reminder. All right, my friends. So our last question for today is actually for all of you that are watching. And I have a quick sort of like trivia question so that I can send you one of these super cool rainbow stickers. And the rainbow sticker is for the first person that answers our trivia question correctly in the chat. So if you were watching the chat or read our little tab on Nneka's work, the question that I want you to answer in the chat is, Nneka's work was recently published on the cover of what magazine? So go ahead and type in the chat if you know the answer. And first one is going to win this super awesome thing. My super cool sticker here. Okay, y'all, giving you a chance to type. What magazine was Nneka's work recently published on the cover? Yay, art teacher Mrs. Wicks. All right, girl. For any art teacher. Oh, you guys are so fast. I have so many people answering. Okay, art teacher Mrs. Wicks, you're my winner, my friend. All right, I'm just writing down that name, and then I will message you. Nneka, thank you so much for joining us today. Your work is stunning, and I really hope you continue to share your work, because it is so beautiful and really gets those conversations started. So thank you for being willing to chat with us today, and for creating your work. Thank you so much. All right, y'all, I'm going to share a bunch of Nneka's work in the story here so you can follow along. And can you remind us again where your Instagram handle is, and then your website if anyone wants to follow along?
It's at RTUHungry, and my website is www.RTUHungry.com.
Perfect. Easy peasy. All right, I'll go ahead and share those in the story, and this will be saved to the IGTV. Thanks, Nneka. We will chat later. Bye, y'all.
Bye.